Good evening, Spring Church. Good to see all your beautiful faces on another Sunday afternoon, or I guess imagine your faces on another Sunday afternoon. Would you pray with me? Jesus, we thank you for your character. We thank you for who you are. God, that you don't come in violence or manipulation or what the world seems to be able to come up with, but you come with kindness, Lord, that leads us to repentance. You're breathing new life. And so we worship you and we thank you for who you are. Amen.
The power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I be set free. Whoa, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for that you've done for me. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. The King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, You're the Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, may we rest in His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. And Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord. Stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm,
God, You're so good. Let us just imagine, but not imagine, but let us experience what it feels like to be dressed in Your righteousness alone. God, that Your presence would be so close that it would feel like we're robed in it. We just want to feel Your nearness, God. We give You all the glory. Praise.
welcome to the spring. So glad you're worshiping with us. Happy Mother's Day to you, to all of you moms out there. We're grateful for you. A couple of announcements. This past Wednesday, our church participated in iHelp, where we fed the homeless. Grateful to all of you who participated and the team who served the homeless on Wednesday. We want to remember populations, groups that are the most vulnerable in this time of COVID, and not forget them and to serve them. A couple things coming up. This week, we're going to have a movie discussion with the movie Parasite. It is rated R. It deserves that rating. But if you want to be a part of that discussion, we think there's some pretty exciting things to discuss about it. Email me and I'll get you an invitation to the Zoom room. We're also making emergency packs for the TCAA, the Tempe Community Action Agency. They're a marvelous group of people. Go to our website, learn more about it to be a part of it. And then if you need to talk to someone, if you want to connect with someone at the spring, if you want to be in a small group, you want to learn more about the spring, email me, email Gail. Again, our information's on the website. You can learn a lot of us there. It's a great place to go. Now I want to invite you to transition with me into a time of prayer. This is a time where we don't collect our thoughts together. It's a time where we come before God and we ask God to move. Now today's prayer won't be a lament in what we are a very big season of lament. Now Gail's sermon will encounter and engage the topic of lament. But I thought today we would base our prayer on Psalm 103. So would you join your hearts with mine and let's pray. With the psalmist, we say, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all his benefits. We thank you, God, that you forgive all our sins, that you heal us from our diseases. It is you who redeems our lives from the pit and crowns us with steadfast love and mercy. You satisfy us with good as long as we live, so that our youth is renewed like the eagles. We thank you, Lord, that you work vindication and justice for all who are oppressed, that you made your ways known to Moses, your acts to the people of Israel, and your love through the life, death, and resurrection of your son Jesus, who is the Messiah. And we rejoice that your son Jesus, the crucified one, has ascended on high to be our great high priest to constantly make intercession for us. We are grateful that you, O Lord, are merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. We are grateful that you will not always accuse, that you will not keep your anger forever. We thank you that you do not deal with us according to our sins, nor pay us back according to our iniquities. We remember that as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is your steadfast love towards those who fear you. As far as the east is from the west, so you remove our transgressions far from us. As a father or a mother has compassion for their children, so you, O Lord, have compassion for those who fear you. For you know how we were made. You remember that we are dust. As for us mortals, our days are like grass. They flourish like the flower of the field, for the wind passes over it and it is gone, and its place knows it no more. But your steadfast love is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear you, and your righteousness to children's children, to those who keep your covenant and remember to do your commandments. You established your throne in the heavens. Your kingdom rules over all. Bless the Lord, O you, his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding, obedient to his spoken word. Bless the Lord, all his hosts, his ministers that do his will. Bless the Lord, all his works in all places of his dominion. With the psalmist, we say, bless the Lord, O my soul. Now, O Lord, hear us as we join our hearts and voices together to pray the prayer that your Son has taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. This is a time in worship when we respond to God. We call it offering. It's a time when we give. Now, obviously, we're not passing plates because that wouldn't make any sense right now. So you may be giving online or through the mail, however you're giving. We want to thank you for those of you who are being so faithful in this time. But give to God. Give to God. Give to God not only of your resources, but your whole life. Worship the Lord who's been so generous with you. Let's continue with our offering.
Have you ever been in a relationship with somebody and started to wonder if they care about you? Or maybe you've wondered if you cared about them? Well, I was thinking about this week, and I found some e-cards and memes that might help capture the angst of that feeling. Since it's Mother's Day, I looked for one specifically for mothers, and I found this one that is from one mom to another. It's a text, and it says, "I'm done. I'm selling my kid on eBay." And the response was, "Don't be silly. You made him. Sell him on Etsy." Sometimes you're just done. You don't care anymore. Or sometimes you wonder if the other person cares about you. Here's one. "You're pretty emotionally unavailable for someone who shares every single one of their feelings on social media." Or this one. "Just wanted to check in and see how not answering my calls is going." Ah, things that make you wonder if someone cares about you. We can smile at some of these, but the truth is that it's really painful when you wonder if God cares about you. And that's what's happening in the scripture tonight. I'm going to be reading from Mark chapter 4, beginning at the 35th verse, where the disciples wonder if Jesus cares for them. "On that day, when evening had come, he said to them, 'Let us go across to the other side.' And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat so that the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, 'Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?' He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, 'Peace, be still.' Then the wind ceased, and there was dead calm. He said to them, 'Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?' And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, 'Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?'" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Pray with me. Lord Jesus, we are here because we really want to hear you speak to us. And so would you speak deep into the recesses of our hearts and our souls, our minds, our wills. Open our ears that we might hear. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Well, the text begins on that day. On what day? The day begins at the beginning of chapter 4, where Jesus is teaching and such a large crowd gathers that he ends up getting into a boat and teaching from the boat all day long. He's teaching them about parables about the kingdom of God. He's hoping that they'll listen. He's urging them to pay attention, to become a part of this movement that has begun in his arrival on the earth. Jesus has been talking and showing what this kingdom of God is like, that it's a kingdom of love and justice and righteousness and shalom, that kind of peace that is wholeness for all of creation. He says at the end of the day to the disciples, "Let's go to the other side of the lake," or the Sea of Galilee, as it is known. He wants to take the message of the kingdom to the people who are on the other side of the lake. And so he gets out of one boat and he gets into their boat and they go across to the other side. The problem is that on the Sea of Galilee, when high winds come, it becomes a very dangerous place. The language actually in the text is reminiscent of the language that's used in the book of Jonah when the storm pummels the boat that Jonah is sleeping in. It's dark, it's confusing, it's chaotic, it's completely out of control. Some of the disciples are actually experienced fishermen, but this is way out of their control as well. The boat would look something like this boat. It's a boat that was found in 1986 by two fishermen who were walking alongside the Sea of Galilee. There had been a 4-year drought, a severe drought, and this boat had been buried in the mud, but there was just enough peeking up that they saw it, and people dug it up, and carbon dating and other technology shows that it dates back to the time of Jesus. It would have seated probably 15 people. And you can see, imagine this boat of this size when a huge wind rose up, or some translations call it a furious squall. In the Greek language, it can also be translated hurricane. It just would be pummeled. It was being swamped. And Jesus, of course, was asleep. You can kind of imagine the scene, right? Maybe people throwing up over the side of the boat. So they're crying, they're screaming, they're doing everything in their power to try to get control. And Jesus is asleep. The disciples wake him up and they say, "Don't you care about what's happening to us? Don't you care?" It's actually a cry of lament. It's a cry that disciples through the ages have cried out when they're in a terrible storm. I want to talk about what the disciples do. I want to talk about what Jesus does in response. And I want to talk just a few minutes about what we can know and see about Jesus. The disciples lament. "Do you care?" they say. Have you ever wondered if God cares? If you have, you're in good company. Moses delivered the oppressed people out of Egypt, and then they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years, often wondering, does God care? David was anointed king, and then he was a fugitive for years, running and hiding from King Saul, who wanted to kill him. Many of the Psalms that he wrote have this kind of underlying theme. Do you care? He wrote in Psalm 13, "How long, Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long?" How long really means how much longer. How much longer? In other words, David had been praying and praying and praying and waiting and waiting and waiting for a long time. The disciples don't understand yet who Jesus is. It's early in the story, actually. And they don't have any idea what's coming at them. They have no idea the storms that will come at them when they in turn begin to advance the kingdom of God in a world that resists it with almost everything it has, even to the point of violence. They're going to need to learn to trust him and to rely on his power. But at this point, they're just saying, "Do you care?" Have you ever wondered if God cares? Maybe you've prayed and prayed and God hasn't answered, or hasn't given you the answer you wanted. Or you observe the suffering and the injustice in the world and you just think, "God, do you care?" Or something tragic happens. "God, you could have done something to stop this. Do you care?" When you're thinking things like that, turn it into a prayer. It's a prayer of lament. "Don't you care? They're saying, is this how it all ends, God? The miracles, the teachings, the healings, and it ends with us drowning in a boat, really? The end? Don't you care? The truth about lament is that it can only happen when we're in a safe, loving, covenantal relationship. I can say what I feel to my husband because I'm in a safe, loving, covenantal relationship. And I know that he's not going to walk out or love me any less at the end of the conversation. We're in a loving, safe, covenantal relationship with God from the moment we put our faith in Jesus. Lament keeps us tethered to God. It keeps us connected to God, much like a difficult conversation with a family member or a good friend keeps us connected to them. We may be hurt, we may be hurting, but we're connected because we're talking it out. That's lament. Lament keeps us tethered to the Lord, and it's related to hope, by the way, because it's directed to God, and hope comes from God. The book of Lamentations is such a good example of lament. In it, Jeremiah just has this gut-wrenching description of what's happening to our ancestors. It's just gut-wrenching. But in the middle of the book, he says these words, I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Lament keeps us tethered to the Lord. Tethered to the Lord, the one who brings life out of death. The one who wakes up and says to the storm, peace, be still. It happens relatively quickly in this passage of scripture. It doesn't always happen that quickly, though, in other places in scripture or in our own lives. We don't know when or how. What we do know is that he wakes up and he says, peace, be still, and that no storm lasts forever. Notice what Jesus does in the storm. He rebukes the storm, not the disciples. I don't know about you, but sometimes, especially when I'm overwhelmed with fear, I feel bad about that. I wish I wasn't so fearful. And I can project onto God the feelings that I'm having about myself. I'm frustrated that I'm feeling this way, or angry that I'm feeling this way. And then I think, well, but God must be angry or disappointed, or maybe thinks I'm a bad Christian or something. So I love how Mark tells this story. He rebukes the storm, not the people. Their fear is overwhelming. It's screaming at them, you're going to die, you're going to die, you're going to die. And Jesus speaks a stronger word, a more powerful word. They weren't sure that God cared a lick about them until they saw what God could do. Several years ago, many years ago now, I was in the midst of a really bad storm for myself. I had some friends that I thought were good friends who deeply hurt me. I was in a lot of physical pain. I was clinically depressed. And probably worst of all, I just felt abandoned by God. Around the corner from our house, we have a little park. We call it the Circle Park. And every morning I would get up and I would walk around and around and around that park. And I would talk and talk and talk and talk and tell God all my hurt and all my anger and all my disappointment and frustration. And I would go around and around and talk and talk and talk and talk until eventually I would have some sense of peace. Be still. I'm God. I've got you. I've got this. I'm going to show you a way out. I'd wake up the next morning, and man, I'd be at it again. I'd be walking and walking and talking and talking and talking until eventually I'd get some sense of peace, be still, I'm God. And this went on for weeks. And eventually it happened that I would talk less and I was able to listen a little better. And then I began to get some clarity on what I needed to do, and the courage to do it. And there came a day when it was a real peace, be still, and there was dead calm. That storm was over once and for all. I'm sure that some of you have been through something similar, maybe more than once. The thing that this scripture raises for me is that it's not just a physical storm, but the physical storm raises a spiritual storm, really. The disciples had lost confidence in Jesus. And so after everything was calm and steady, Jesus says, "Do you still have no faith?" They'd lost confidence in him. And boy, they were going to need to trust him if they were going to be able to do the things that he was calling them to do. There's going to be much greater storms ahead for them. So Jesus shows him his power, and it's greater than any storm they're ever going to face. It's greater than any storm you'll ever face or I will ever face. I love Dallas Willard's words. Jesus had complete confidence in God's power, and he intended to establish that same confidence in his disciples. Can you imagine that? Just think on that a minute, that Jesus wants to instill in you and in me the same confidence in God's power that Jesus had himself. "Why are you afraid?" he asks. I think those are tender words. Have you still no faith? They don't know who he is yet. It is still early in the story. They don't know he's the Messiah. They don't know that he's God incarnate. Do you know that? Do you know that? Do you know that he is more powerful than any storm you will ever face? 1 John 4:4 says, "The one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world." Do you believe that God's Spirit, the one who is in you, if you've put your faith in Jesus, that God's Spirit, the one who is in you, is greater than any evil that is in the world? Do you believe that? It's a challenge, isn't it? Jesus asking that question is him really saying, "Hey, are you and I okay? How are we doing, you and I, in this moment?" The way you answer his question is really important. Have you still no faith? Do you trust me? He's saying. You see, part of the answer to the question, "Does God care?" is how we answer the question, "Who is Jesus? Who is Jesus?" The disciples are terrified at the end of the story. It's a kind of fear that is more like awe than the kind of shaking fear that they had before. It's unsettling to them. "Who is this?" they say. "But even the wind and the sea obey him." Who is this? Well, we know he's the Messiah. We know that he's God incarnate. We know a lot about him. But there are some things we don't know. In Isaiah 55, God says, "My thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are my ways your ways, nor are your ways my ways. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts." God is always up to something higher than you can see, bigger than you can see. Always. The Apostle Paul describes it this way: "For now we see in a mirror dimly, then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known." One day we will see fully, clearly. Former professor at Yale, Nicholas Wolterstorff, lost his 25-year-old son, Eric, in a tragic climbing accident. He wrote about the experience in a book he called Lament for a Son. In the book, he wrote about his own questions about God. And they were big ones. I mean, God, why did you allow this? Why didn't you do something? He wrote about going to the grave to try to say goodbye to a son. And he said these words: "I wonder how it will all go when God raises him and the rest of us from the dead. Giving us new bodies seems no great problem, but how is he going to fit us all into his city?" Eric here, man of the 20th century, has to be fitted in with someone who lived long ago in primitive conditions. Will God have everyone learn computers? Eric would have a head start. And what about the different characters and the temperaments that all these people bring? And so many, so innumerably many. God alone has them all in mind. I don't see how he's going to bring it off. But I suppose if he can create, he can recreate. I wonder if it's all true. I wonder if he's really going to do it. Will I hear Eric say, "Hey, Dad, I'm back"? But remember, God said, "I made all this and I raised my son from the dead. So, okay. Goodbye, Eric. Goodbye, goodbye. Until we see." Friends, someday you're going to see how much God cared. Someday you're going to see how much he loved you. Someday you're going to see all the grace that's in store. And the way I know this is because God didn't just kickstart the world or jumpstart it and say, "Okay, now you're on your own." But he actually entered our world in the person of Jesus. And he suffered with us. And he went to the cross. And he died for our sins. And he went to the grave. And then on the third day, woohoo, he said, "Dad, I'm back." I think it'd be a good time for us to talk to him. Would you pray with me, please? Jesus, it can be so hard to trust you. It can be so hard to know because we can't see. We don't know what you're doing behind the scenes. So we can't tell what it's all about when we're in the midst of a storm. We don't understand why the circumstances are the way they are. And yet we are confronted with this amazing truth that you did not remain at a distance. That you stepped into our world to be with us, to suffer for us, to go to that cross, to go to the tomb, to come out of that grave. So we could look forward to that one day when that'll be our story. Your story will be our story. And we can look you in the eye and say, hey, Dad, I'm back. So help us cling to that. Help us cling to that hope today as we try in one little way right now to take a step of trust towards you and to hang on and believe that you're the one who holds the power over sin and death and darkness, and that there's nothing we have to fear. We pray this in your amazing name. Amen.
Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
And now to him who by the power at work within us is able to do far more abundantly than we can ask or imagine, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to every generation, now and forever. Amen and amen.
A son is Adam, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace.